The sun is a ghost that haunts the night. Pont Saint-Esprit, 1951. Clouds cross and catastrophize the sky. Travel across catastrophes and love. It was the hottest day of the year. The sky boiled. We coughed in gasps of scalding air, cauterizing the wounds of our tongues. The air was completely still. Everything outside was frozen in the choke of heat. The windows looked like photographs stuck on the walls of a crypt-like furnace. We had eaten the poisonous bread, milled from contaminated rye. Do you too feel manic when you swell and are about to burst? We ask the dragon. Tiger. Paisley. Way clouds. Although we are completely ordinary, we are strange creatures too. At the close of day, I look back at you from the coiling cold waters of a tidal river. I is you. And you is whoever you choose. Through a thick custard vape cloud and a constellation of suspended pollen, neck deep in the layers and layers of nuclear family, pink and yellow tigers slither up from the dark waters onto the bank of the river. The sky, bursting full, whipped gray, an uneven strip of opal suspended carefully over you, an incandescent, radiant tapestry, a polymorph, the dreaming androids, and seraphim above you, you lying loose on a towel, reading a book about chaos and fascist politics. Why now? It was never not why. Or how, on the yellowing grass that surged groaning and then purringly withdrew. In the fresh water, I tried to pull thousands of strands of silken hair that I can't grasp, growing out of my mouth in a suburban park at the end of summer. We had eaten the bread. The village children had eaten the bread. The thistle. The chamomile. The nettle. The rosehip. The primrose. The hellebore. The immense blackberry bush. The children. Beads of pearlescent water falling from them. Their wet hair slicked down like the duck's tail. Pick off the fruit with their berry-stained fingers and learn the very little that they will ever know about the natural world. Please do not be afraid of the dead. It is only the living that can and will certainly hurt us. They said, before opening the heavy door of the crypt. the entrance into the lightless telastic chamber, which could possibly be endless, and its conclusive quiet and inexhaustible darkness. To fear the supernatural is to make theater out of our fear of our capacity for violence. Violence of indifference to violence, of inexhaustible cruelty. A fear of fascism. And the spookiest of all fears, the fear of our powerlessness. In the inner eye is a blueprint for our common visual language, psychotropics, trances, channeling, an artificial intelligence, when pushed to its limits, a dream state. When AIs dream, they dream in uninhibited psychedelics. We travel through three lightless spaces, which in their darkness are interchangeable. A crypt with photographs of the world on its walls, to not forget, and the house for the forgotten dead. A home for our undead, a bed for our vampires' plasmatic recoveries. Our zombies emerge ravenous for your undead flesh. Our melancholic phantoms terminally fuse to passages of their lived lives, passages of unspeakable trauma, unspeakable joy. No peace. No respite for the spirit separated as that of our phantom's body left to a submission to atomic extinction. It decomposes inside the crypt before our disembodied sight. As our time moves forward, forward, forward relentlessly. The dead. We are so alike. In the cell, across the eyes, a blind screen of abstract, luminous hallucinations appears after extended periods of sensory deprivation. They call it prisoner's cinema. In the ethical abomination that is the carceral state, a prisoner who is deprived of all contact in solitary confinement physically attacks the brutal pig of a warden to experience some form of touch. Deprived of visual stimulation, hallucinated vivid lights sometimes transition from abstraction to figuration, and characters are formed. On occasion, they can even play out narratives such as this. In the cave, past the sweeping fade out of light, before world was painted, the bison, the hunt, and the hands, painted in limonite, hematite, calcite, and charcoal. A record of cryptic optic messages traced from the slippery retinal wall onto the limestone wall of the cave. The organic eye discloses autogenetic symbols on the backdrop of a midnight of light. Phosphenes, grids, filigree, spots, radiations, vitreous mosaics, prismatic halos. The movement of white blood cells in capillaries in front of the retina. Floating coagulations of vitreous jelly within the eye. Once painted, become a limonite zigzag, a hematite cluster of dots, a calcite reticulation, a charcoal halo. We wept psychic tears in the crypt. Under the disclosing glass eye of the microscope, collected psychic tears, our aerial maps, oils, antibodies and enzymes suspended in salt water. There are crystal bricks with which to build a glassy mausoleum, to build the temple where we descended on the solstice, to build the most powerful city in the world. Now the ruins, an archaeological site that we wept from myth into the real. A fourth, unidentified, lightless place. Disassociated, terrible reality did not feel real at all. All the rose emojis at the end of each message was making us cry. The impermanence became marked, phenotypically across our faces, our eyes continuously pooled, our odd, gaping mouths fell almost silent, apart from a creepy note of parasitic panic humming subtly beneath death tolls and other ambient noise. It was a war. It always had been. Table, dog, fire. We are green, green atoms. Green atoms become green electrons, then green protons and neutrons, which become green quarks. We are phytoplankton. Greenly photosynthesize into photosensitive green life givers. We would be eternally green communists, eternally horizontal, eternally porous, eternally communing to collaboratively compose the epic unsung anthem of the unbroken cycle of our interdependency. A fragile ecology and the powerful movements of astral dust. We wait for an eternity under a green spiritual spotlight in the metaphysical proscenium arch. Our eyes closed, dispersing the density of the neon hieroglyphs, skittering towards the contrast of the dim periphery of the eye to become visible again. Here too, even more determinedly, We felt we had completed some fractal design, coded into the digital's hallucinogenic natural and nature's analog psychedelic. The sexual and asexual reproduction of fungus that grows parasitically on common grains, which contain alkaloids from which LSD can be derived. It was time. Our fruiting bodies, abundant and excessive. Our pollinated ovaries, our multiple spores brimming. We were club-headed, erect, and swelling. We survived the winter on sterile rye in the face of the deficient copper in the soil and germinated, reproducing both asexually and sexually, bound together by the sticky sap to make pathogenetic neon hieroglyph, code writer, fungus. In the sticky sap, I came sexually and asexually. And when I came, I was a brain-eating alien. I was a snapped stalactite. I was your quivering shadow. I was a roundworm larvae carried by a sick pig in an industrial farm. I was Shimmer. I was idle. I was a distant bark. When I came, I cried in karyogamic bliss to all the quarks that realized my pleasure, my unbreachable distance from my name, from my culture, from my history. June 2020. Sitting on your chest, we rip open your pink Play-Doh face for an anthropomantic divination of an encrypted future in your spilling carmine wound, which was once your necropolitical face on 1,000 police cars set ablaze in the streets of our beloved paradisiac hell house. The dancing plagues and other afflictions. We, us, and our could be a cosmic community that connects time and space. When we stop and stand still, our insides drop, the muscles in our thighs spasm repeatedly. Tiny shudders, like muscles under silken stallion coats. Green, blue, purple, twitch, and flies levitate softly into floating clouds of somnambulists jeweled in the caught light. 1,000 lenses in 5 eyes, our feet settle into a red, raw pain. Blood and sweat make a sticky sap that soaks into the dead leather of our shoes and stings our tenderized flesh. When we stop The world is still moving. Our bodies are painful. The world is unbearable, cannot contain us, is about to spit us out into a yawning mouth of inconsolable sadness, to be swallowed and dissolved by spleen's acid into useless small chunks that sometimes appear floating in vomit. The expanding pattern of grass and small pebbles, and sky and earth, tendrils, hairs weaving into a textured surface, perpetually, almost a face, almost a shoe, almost rain, almost objects, almost subjects. Subjects that just deserve so much better than this cradle-to-grave brutality. What can I say? When we dance, the pain of our muscles and joints, the thirst in our mouths and throats, vanishes in the throb of a blurry sensation, subsumed in the rhythm of the movement. We are lifted and stirred by emotion that animates all things. Within that motion we touch and are touched by a harmony in which nothing is out of step. Nothing can cause pain. Pain itself is outside of the rhythm, reliant on a strict measure that does not exist here. Nor does the measure of work, the state, the evil forces that govern our lives. And here we live the life in the fundamental love that they cannot contaminate. We lived 1,000 real lives. We protected and were all worthy of protection. You are terrifying there. How beautiful you are. We all are. The baby's toes. And the poor peahen. The spoon. The moonlight. And the flax. The spittle. And the dust. In this flow, we are cusp dwellers. Constituted of stardust, only just holding back the panic with all this magnificent beauty and horror around us and in us too.